Friends, Jesus said, "Where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am in the midst of them." I welcome you this day to our time of worship together. And as we gather with the light of Christ that illumines all of our lives. May the light and peace of Christ be with you all this day and always. I invite us at the beginning of our worship today to pause for a moment, to pause and to remember the victims of the Nova Scotia tragedy that happened last weekend. I invite us now to just take this moment of silence to lift up the prayers that are on our hearts for all of these people who mourn the loss of so many in their lives. And we light a candle this morning to remember them. Let us pray this morning for all of those who have suffered through this tragedy, and I will be using the words from our moderator, the Reverend Richard Bott, as we pray. Let us pray. Holy God, for the people of Portapique, neighbors and community grieving this day, I pray. For victims of the shooting, I pray. For their pain and their loss, for their shock and confusion, for all that has happened because of this violence, I pray your grace, your compassion, your strong presence, your overwhelming love. God of all creation, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now I invite you to listen to this special song that is being offered by our own Lisa and Jessica Dottie Kinnett. And may it bring you peace and comfort in this time of horrific tragedy.
Clouds in the sky, you'll get by.
As we come together in worship this day, we acknowledge that we need God's presence on the long road. The road between fear and hope, the road between the place where all is lost and the place of resurrection. And like the disciples walking on the road to Emmaus, we are in need of Jesus to walk with us, to stand among us in his risen power, that this time of worship may be a hallowed hour. Let us pray. Loving God, come and speak to our hearts today. May we, like those on the road to Emmaus, find your words burning with hope in our lives. Strengthen us and give us courage for the journey ahead. For we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" And they replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty indeed and word before God and all the people,
and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. And moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted it to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them, and when he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed it and broke it and gave it to them, and their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. And they said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, when he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of bread.
Thank you.
invite you today to picture in your mind our story from the Gospel of Luke that was just read. Two disciples are leaving Jerusalem, fleeing in sorrow, fearful and heartbroken, telling their tragic story to each other. I'm sure you can imagine it. Perhaps this year we can even better relate to these two people, held up in their fear and uncertainty of what their future might hold. In the light of events that happened last week in Nova Scotia, because of this shared experience of social isolation, all of us can most certainly identify with the two on the road, perhaps asking the same questions they did, wandering in a mixture of disbelief and grief of what could have been or what will never be now. Perhaps asking, how did this happen? Or how did we get here? Or if only, or why? As they move through their grief and try to make sense of everything that has happened, a stranger approaches them. And it is Jesus, but they don't recognize him. He invites them to share why they are so troubled. And with some surprise at his ignorance to what has been happening the past days, they tell the stranger their terrible story of a life ended, of hopes dashed. And in response, he reminds them of their history, of their faith, of their story as a people of God, inviting them to see the events of the last days in light of their faith and the truth of Scripture. He goes back to their scriptures that they would have known so well and makes new connections in light of this new experience. This stranger listens to them. He offers them a new perspective, and they yearn to hear more. So they invite him into their home to stay. Stay with us, they say. You need a shelter, a meal. Stay with us. Are we not a lot like those two disciples finding ourselves in some form of in-between space these days? A place between all we thought was certain and an unknown future. For them, it was that road between Jerusalem and its sorrow and Emmaus. A road that meant they were starting over without their beloved leader who would comfort them, support them, teach them, and direct them. And for us, it is sheltering in place where many are disconnected from certainties of job and school. Many are putting their own health and safety on the line to help others, and most of us are wondering what will happen and how to make sense of this life we seem to be living now. And many people today in Nova Scotia and all across Canada are still figuring out how to live through this pandemic, as well as face the shock and horror as they come to terms with life without those they love, whether it be a neighbor or a friend or a family member, gone all too soon and taken senselessly by a random act of violence. Often in the midst of a climate of fear and disorientation, we see uneasy resentments arise, blame and frustration abound, and suspicion and division ensue. But that doesn't have to be the way that we respond. When we're not sure what to believe or what to think or what to expect or even what to dare to hope for, we can choose to respond differently. Those disciples of long ago, in trying to make sense of life after having their world turned upside down, offer an invitation to their home and into their hearts, to the stranger in their midst. They offer hospitality and welcome. Reverend Kate Matthews writes that hospitality isn't a condescending or begrudging, dutiful sharing with others, preferably from our excess, not our substance. That way we won't feel it so much. But it's an openness to the other and to our neighbor. It's also an openness to the lessons they teach, the different perspectives and insights they share, and to the change that may follow. Hospitality welcomes the new learning that change brings, however uncomfortable and perhaps even painful that change may be. Hospitality and openness make transformation possible, especially when brought to us from the most unexpected places by the most unlikely people, particularly by strangers or those especially considered the other. If we believe that we must see Jesus in the least of these, as he taught us, then we have a clear mandate from him to share at our table and its abundance with all who are hungry physically and spiritually. And so we are hearing more and more that there are lessons to be learned in the midst of our troubles and uncertainty and our fears. Lessons about generosity, about sharing with strangers who then become unexpected sources of hope and help, of not fearing the other, of breaking our bread both literally and figuratively with all of God's children. Sharing medical advances and data, caring for one another, perhaps even neighbors we have never met, and speaking up for those hit hardest by the disaster, because for many it's exactly that, bringing devastation of many kinds. Finding creative ways to nurture community and friendship and family across social distances. These are all expressions of hospitality and generosity. And Matthews concludes, we are called to be generous toward and supportive of the frontline workers in both hospitals and grocery stores. We're called to learn about the ways racism plays a role in the disproportionate harm to many. We're called to open our hearts and minds and eyes to the reality of the suffering of our sisters and brothers. How will we respond? I think this time of pandemic is perhaps inviting us to imagine new ways of living and being in this precious world God has created, not only in our own families, but in the ways in which the most vulnerable in our society are being cared for and invited to the table. I think we are being given the opportunity through this most difficult time to reimagine the ways in which God wants us to live and work in the world, and how we might witness to our faith in such a world. In their reaching out with invitation, in the gathering around a table, and in the breaking of bread, the two on the road to Emmaus found Jesus. Were not our hearts burning within us? They remembered of their encounter on the road. A flame of hope was lit within them that day as they experienced the grace of Jesus in each of their lives. John Wesley spoke of his experience of encountering the grace of God firsthand as a time when his heart was strangely warmed. Burning hearts strangely warmed, our hearts ablaze with the promise of resurrection and new life, with the good news that fear and death do not have the final word, that love is stronger than hatred, that peace is indeed a possibility. Theologian William Willimon said that the resurrection has a way of penetrating deep into our lives, enabling us to see the world not as a place of ultimate death and defeat, but as a place that is waiting for God's ultimate victory. Easter is the experience of the power of God, the recognition that life is stronger than death and love is stronger than hate. The two followers didn't keep this powerful encounter with Jesus to themselves. They were compelled to take this good news back to their community and share it. My friends, will we do the same? God's life and grace and the gift of resurrection are wonderful things to know about, but they mean very little in real terms without a response from us. While God's grace and love are always available, it is as we respond that we are able to appropriate and benefit from them. The two disciples on the Emmaus Road heard about Jesus' resurrection, but it is only when they recognize him at the meal as he breaks bread that the reality of the resurrection hits home to them and they experience it for themselves. It is not that God needs our response in order to love us or forgive us or save us, but that for us to know, experience, and live out the life and grace of God, we need to appropriate what God has given us and respond to the realities that we encounter. Resurrection is what God is doing in the world in all sorts of ways, and we are called to cooperate and co-create with God as this life-giving work is happening. In what ways can each of us be a part of God's work of resurrection in the most broken and hurting places of our world this week? No doubt it's a little more difficult as we shelter in place, but there is so much that we can do. We can pray, we can reflect, we can read our scriptures, we can phone and email, we can make a contribution if we are so able to a local food bank or hospice or social organization that is working to support the most vulnerable. We can also sing and perhaps just simply greet the stranger we pass with a smile. We can acknowledge the wonderful work that our frontline workers are doing. Why not write a thank you note and pass it along to the grocery store clerk or cashier? Or leave a freshly baked loaf of bread or muffins or cookies on your neighbor's porch? When we do these things, we open our eyes and our hearts to the power of the risen Christ, and we witness to our hope in him to others. So friends, may the Christ who walks on wounded feet walk with you on the road. And may the Christ who serves with wounded hands stretch out your hands to serve. And may the Christ who loves with a wounded heart open your hearts to love. And may you see the face of Christ in everyone you meet. And may everyone you meet see the face of Christ in you. May it be so for you and for me. Invite us now to gather our hearts in prayer. Let us pray. When we are blinded by anger, O God, you pour out your love for all to see. When we wonder about tomorrow and what it will bring, you call us to trust in you. When sadness fills our lives, you plant gladness in our hearts. God of Easter, touch us with your grace. You show us your hands so we may reach out to mend the broken. You show us your feet so we may walk with those the world passes by. You show us your face so we may know what our sisters and brothers look like. Risen Christ, touch us with your compassion. You open our eyes so we may see your love. You open our minds so we may welcome your word. You open our lips so we may be your witnesses. Spirit of hope, touch us with your peace. And now, God in community, holy in one, open us to your presence as we pray all of these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, my friends, go as those who have met with Christ this day. Go now as those whose hearts have burned within them as the scriptures were explained. Go now as those who have been touched by resurrection. And may the blessing of God be upon you, body, mind, and spirit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.